Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Behind the Fireplace, Memoirs of a Girl Working in the Dutch Resistance, by Andrew Scott and Grietje Okma Scott, narrated by Esther Wane. Preface. One day, as a child in Scotland in the early 1960s, my teacher at junior school asked us to find out what our parents had done during the Second World War. My mother talked of her life in Holland and used the words Jews behind the fireplace. But when she tried to explain further, she became so emotional that she was unable to say more. I eventually reported back to my teacher on my father's work in an anti-aircraft battery, but I sensed there was an untold story that I did not yet understand. It was to be almost 40 years before I was to discover the extraordinary narrative behind these words, and another 20 before the story was talked of outside the family. It is with a sense of respect and pride that I now share this story with you, as testimony to my mother's courage and determination in the face of the deeply traumatic events the war unleashed in her world. My mother's story is a profound story of two distinct parts. During World War II, she and her family, the Okmas, sheltered 7 people hiding from the Gestapo, 6 of them Jews, and this led to her becoming absorbed into the Dutch resistance as part of a team fighting the Nazis. After the war, the second part of her ordeal began. She had initially joined the resistance as a payback for the support her family was receiving in sheltering the Jews. At first, her role had been minor, but as the war progressed, the dangers increased, and by the end she had escaped the clutches of the Gestapo 4 times, the last occasion being when she alone, out of a group of some 20 Dutch folk, escaped a firing squad. The events left their legacy, and for years she would wake up at screaming point, overwhelmed by the image of a German soldier silhouetted against a grey sky, pointing his rifle at her as she cowered on the ground. In 1962, she had eventually sought help from a psychiatrist for her debilitating distress. His diagnosis threatened the very fabric of her family. For 18 years, she lived with his threat looming over her, until the last of her children left home. It was only in the 1970s and 1980s, when other organisations started to formally recognise her role in the war, that this recognition gave her the confidence to finally talk to the family about the events of that time. In 1979, she and her family received recognition with the award of the Medal of the Righteous from the Israeli organisation Yad Vashem. In 1980, she applied for a pension from the Dutch foundation, Stichting, 1940 to 1945, an organisation funded to help former members of the wartime resistance. As she prepared for a hearing, she needed to find a witness to provide independent testimony to the foundation. Her boyfriend during the war had been a commander in the resistance, and he agreed to provide testimony. The letter from this recognised resistance commander had concluded with the words, "If you could capture in words what she did when she was in the resistance, you would capture the essence of what the resistance was all about." The writing of this story started in 1992, when I was stationed in Washington, D.C. My mother had come to visit me for 2 weeks, and on the first evening, the conversation had drifted back to the Second World War. She had started talking, first about one event, then another, painting vivid vignettes of times past. She is not a natural storyteller, and I quickly became confused as she hopped back and forth in time, leaving many tales part told, or trailing randomly into other unrelated events. Over some 5 years, I stitched together the fragments, reviewed it with family members, and refined it until it held together. It was circulated round the family, and the recounting and writing gave my mother a degree of therapy and helped put the more strident memories to rest. In 2012, as we celebrated her 90th birthday, we told the local paper a bit about what had happened. The story rapidly gained the attention of the Scottish press, and strangers in the sheltered home where she lived started approaching her and congratulating her, something that gave her a quiet pleasure. Over the years, I was able to trace descendants of all the Jews who had hidden in the house, and, through their comments, gain insight into their parents' experiences, which I have incorporated in this book. The appearance in the press also helped others trace my mother. In 2015, 70 years after the end of the war, the descendants of her wartime boyfriend were able to locate the article in the Scottish press and use it to track her down, and we were able to exchange memories of these past events. Some final pieces of the puzzle fell into place. This is my mother's story. It is the story of a young, single woman in occupied Holland. She was christened Grietje, but was affectionately called Kieks by everyone. The events described here occurred 50 years before I first started to write them down. The first strands my mother related with intensity and anger. Anger directed towards the Germans, the Jews, her family, everyone, and most especially psychiatrists. With the retelling, her anger subsided, and in some cases was redirected. This is not a contemporaneous account, but an attempt to unscramble confused memories, many of which had been locked away unspoken for half a century. There may inevitably be mistakes, inconsistencies, and ambiguities, but I believe these do not detract from the essence of the overall story. All the major events that shaped her war have been included in the story. Finally, I recognise that the experiences she and her family went through were not unique in Holland. When the war ended, thousands of Jewish refugees appeared on the streets all around the country. The people of Holland hid many Jews during the war. These Jews were sheltered by individuals and families such as the Okmas, and these other families suffered similar experiences and pressures. This book is dedicated to all these families. Grietje Okma Scott died in her sleep on the 4th of January, 2016. Part 1. There is a famous Chinese curse. May you live in interesting times. Some people wonder why this is called a curse. There are other people whose children repeatedly ask to be told stories of times gone by, stories they themselves only want to forget. These people understand the curse of living in interesting times. In the aftermath of World War I, Adolf Hitler was starting his rise to power and would spread the shadow of this curse over all of Europe. But in the Holland of 1922, this shadow was faint and far away. With an economic boom underway, universal suffrage finally becoming a reality, life was good in the most pleasant of ways, and for historians perhaps even a little bit dull. In January that year, Kieks was born in the small town of Leeuwarden in Friesland, a rural province in the north of Holland. For some it is perhaps an interesting part of the country, a region with its own culture, dialect and ancient language. In Holland it is known for its beautiful lakes and the exceptional height of its inhabitants. Kieks' father was Dirk Okma, a lawyer and district court judge, who had lived in Leeuwarden for over 20 years, where he had met and married Trouder, whom the family called Muda, with Kieks the youngest of their 8 children. The eldest was Marta, who was 15 years old when Kieks was born, and who had been followed in regular succession by 3 boys, Ruud, 14, Willem, 12, and Dover, 10. They in turn were followed by 3 girls, Trintje, 8, Ella, 5, and Muda's namesake, Trouder, who was 3 at Kieks' birth. Kieks had been christened Grietje, but when she first went to school there were no fewer than 8 girls in her class with the same name. Each had their own nickname, and everyone, including the teacher, used the pet name she had been given by her family, Kieks. Their peaceful life held no foreshadow of the interesting times that would later befall Kieks and her family. They lived comfortably in the small town, enjoying frequent camping holidays and sailing trips on a lake some miles distant. Life was very pleasant. In September 1929, when Kieks was 7, father contracted an infection while sitting in court and died suddenly after a very short illness. The family was devastated. There was little money to cover the needs of his family after he died, and the events left his widow distraught and unable to cope. With the world in the grip of the Great Depression, money now very tight, and with a family to support, In 1936, Muda sold the house and moved to a rented home in Utrecht. By this time, Kieks' older siblings were starting to leave home, with her eldest brother, Ruud, moving away in 1936 to live in Arnhem with his new bride, a girl called Corrie Foss. By the mid-1930s, Kieks' older siblings, Willem and Marta, were occasionally travelling together on summer vacations. In the summer of 1938, they had travelled together down the Rhineland in Germany on a canoeing holiday, but had become uncomfortably aware of the pernicious state-organised anti-Semitism they saw around them, and had been shocked by the indifference of passers-by when Jews were being harassed in the street. The dark throes of Nazi anti-Semitism and persecution were gathering momentum. Just a few months after the holiday, the Okma family were to see newsreels of the horrors of Kristallnacht, when, on the 9th and 10th of November 1938, Nazi supporters swarmed the streets of many towns in Germany, smashing the windows of synagogues and Jewish-owned shops, strewing the streets with shards of glass that glistened like fragments of crystal in the moonlight. They saw images of several of the towns that Willem and Marta had visited earlier, images that moved them deeply, images that would influence Willem's thinking when the war finally started. Disgusted by the events they had witnessed, Willem and Marta couldn't face the prospect of returning to Germany for their next vacation in the early summer of 1939, and instead decided to travel over to Glasgow. The city had received a lot of publicity in the papers in 1938 because of the Empire Exhibition, a large spectacle and exposition celebrating Britain's empire and Scotland's role in it. They had a good time, and for a little while put aside thoughts of the clouds gathering over Europe as they explored the city and enjoyed features described in the reports of the exhibition. Afterwards, journeying by train to the city of Hull to catch the ferry on to Rotterdam, they met a Scotsman, Archie Scott, setting out on his first trip to the continent. Willem and Marta could hardly speak a word of English, while Archie couldn't speak any Dutch. However, they had each learnt a little French at school, and Archie had perhaps more confidence in his French than his skills justified. So, with a combination of pidgin French and plenty of gesticulations, they passed the time genially to Hull. Once they arrived, Archie said farewell and disappeared to collect his bag from the guard van. A few minutes later, they came across him again on the platform. His luggage had just been sent on the wrong train down to London. The railways had promised to bring it back in a couple of days, but Archie announced that he would travel on without it. He had only 2 weeks' holiday a year and did not want to spend half of it waiting for a suitcase. Willem invited him to visit the family at Utrecht, so Archie travelled with them and spent a week with the Okmas until his luggage finally arrived. In Utrecht, he met the other family members, including Kieks, who was now 17, and provided entertainment for all as he continued to communicate with them using mime and his unique pidgin French. Kieks was amused at just how bad his French was, but she was impressed at his willingness to make the effort to communicate, and at his remaining unfazed when his attempts raised the occasional laugh. Soon after coming to Utrecht, Willem accepted a job offer in a meat processing company, a job that meant he had to move to The Hague. At about the same time, his older brother, Douwe, announced that he was going to get married, so the family was again in flux. As 1939 rolled on, Willem went house hunting and eventually found a suitable apartment for the family. The address was 18 Citroenstraat, located in an anonymous middle-class street in a maze of similar ones in the suburbs of The Hague. The building was attached to the end of a row of three-storey houses that had been constructed a few years earlier and formed a continuous terrace with another apartment block on the other side, abutting onto the building's stairwell. Their apartment was quite generous in size, taking up the top three of four floors, with two reception rooms on the lowest floor and three bedrooms on the floor above. On the top floor, there was another bedroom and a small box room, which Willem agreed to convert into a workroom. At the back, there were small open-air walkways on the second and third floors that were just wide enough to hang out washing to dry. Willem was pleased with the apartment and invited the rest of the family in Utrecht to join him in The Hague. Kieks had found it difficult to settle in Utrecht, and so in some ways she was quite happy with the move, although a little disappointed that the new apartment was smaller than the one in Utrecht and that she would now have to share a bedroom with her eldest sister, Marta. Her brother, Dalva, would not be joining them, as he was now engaged to be married, and she was very conscious that the family was dispersing, as her siblings began to meet partners and go their separate ways. She was not ready to do that yet, but she wondered how many of the others would soon be making new lives for themselves and moving on. Perhaps there would be more space for her in the house before long. In May, as international tensions grew and war threatened, most of the Okmas moved into the house. Dalva stayed behind in Utrecht until 2 months later when he got married, and, with his bride Tini, left for a house in Hillegom, a pretty village in the tulip fields some 40 kilometres to the north, just south of Haarlem. With the new arrangements, the four-bedroom house was to be shared by the seven of them, Muda, Marta, who was now 32, Willem, Ella, Trincher, Trouder, and Kieks, now 17. Kieks had just failed her school-leaving exams in Utrecht, so as soon as the move was completed, she registered locally for evening classes to resit them, and also signed up for a professional needlework class. Settling in, Kieks increasingly enjoyed the new location. There were now quite a few other family members nearby, aunts and cousins whom she had only seen infrequently before. One was Kieks' cousin, Guido van Dett, who lived in a suburb of Amsterdam. Guido was a couple of years older than Kieks, and they became good friends soon after the move from Utrecht, meeting up frequently and enjoying each other's company. He was a puppeteer, making a living from a marionette show, and by 1938 had an assistant whom he had recruited a year or two previously. She was of Dutch East Indies origin, and he had selected her because of her good looks and her jet-black complexion. He was convinced her dramatic looks would surely distinguish his act from any others, which seemed to work, because he had occasional bookings at the Royal Palace, where he entertained Queen Wilhelmina's children. In September 1939, just a few months after the family had moved to The Hague, war broke out between Britain and Germany. Though Germany had issued a guarantee of neutrality to Holland, martial law was nevertheless declared that month, and as the Dutch troops were gradually mobilised, Willem was drafted. The family was not too worried. They could not believe that Holland would really fight their German neighbours, and in any case, they were a religious family who devoutly believed in God, and they were convinced that he would look after Willem. He was posted to the German border from where the invasion would surely come. Despite the policy of neutrality, the Germans invaded Holland on the 10th of May 1940, without a formal declaration of war. Within days, they had bombed the centre of Rotterdam until it was little more than a shell. The Rotterdam Blitz aimed mainly at civilian targets, destroyed 25,000 homes and killed around 900 civilians. Germany then gave an ultimatum that unless the country surrendered, another five cities would suffer the same fate. Holland surrendered, and by the end of May 1940, the country was occupied. The Dutch troops were ordered back to the barracks and confined under armed guard. A few days after the surrender, Kieks decided to go to the local barracks and view the bomb damage that some of her friends had been talking about. She had been shocked at the sudden news of dramatic bombings and battles, and felt she needed to see with her own eyes some evidence of what was happening. She saw people milling about in the barracks grounds, and found herself observing some rehearsal in the parade ground. The occupying forces seemed to be preparing for an event in the city centre, while a large number of Dutch soldiers stood lined against the perimeter fence, watching proceedings. Kieks spotted one soldier with his arm out behind him, waving a small card through the railings, hidden from the sight of the German guards. Curious, she went over, and realised it was a postcard to his family. It reminded her of her own brother, and how the whole family was waiting anxiously for news. So she took it and posted it in the nearby postbox. When she looked round, there were now a few more cards being waved through the railings, and as she started collecting these, yet more appeared. She made a number of trips, realising that the soldiers were circulating to allow others to pass her their cards. Eventually the flow of cards dried up and Kieks went back home, pleased to have helped this subterfuge. A cousin of Kieks, Tina von Tett, was a police inspector who frequently called round to visit Marta. Kieks found her to be an intimidating woman, and so tried to fade into the background whenever she visited. A few days after the postcard incident, Tina called round on one of her visits and spotted Kieks in the living room, discreetly attempting to leave. She challenged Kieks to explain what she was doing to resist the occupation. When Kieks made no reply, Tina frowned. Couldn't she do more? Why, Tina had heard that even one of those tarts from around the barracks had done her bit. The girl had gone round and collected a large pile of postcards from the soldiers and posted them. If the likes of that tart could do something, surely Kieks could think of something useful. Kieks always found it difficult to talk to Tina, and was especially flustered this time, but was determined not to be associated with those tarts, and said nothing as she slipped out of the room. Police Inspector Tina was in her late 40s. Soon after the invasion, she had started to organise a resistance movement, gathering support from a large number of the police staff who worked with her. She worked on the principle that, by appearing to cooperate with the Germans, the Dutch police would be trusted more, which would give them more opportunities to spot and exploit German weaknesses. She was unable to carry out this role for long. She was arrested by the German occupying forces following an incident at an internment camp and sent off to one of the special punishment camps that were being set up. Her offence had occurred at the time when the Dutch had been interning German citizens, just before the invasion. She had reprimanded a German woman who had tried to grab a towel during the registration process. When the occupying forces took over, the woman sought Tina out and had her arrested for insulting the German people. Willem returned home within a couple of months of the occupation, but said little about his experiences at the front. The scenes in the newsreels of Kristallnacht preyed on his mind, and he feared how events might unfold in Holland. Kieks was 12 years younger than the 13-year-old Willem, and as his little Zusje, not particularly close. She sensed that something troubling was on his mind, and that he would not be discussing it with her. A few days after he got home, the doorbell rang. When he answered the door, there before him were two postal workers making a special delivery. He was presented with a letter from overseas that had somehow been allowed through, in spite of the war. On looking at it, he realised that it was from Archie Scott, the man who had stayed with them the previous year. The letter had been forwarded via their old address in Utrecht, and simply thanked them for their hospitality and asked after their health. Willem took it from the senior officer, who clearly seemed to know the contents, and tried to casually explain how amusing it all was and how little contact they had had with the man. When he went back into the house, the family could see that he was unsettled by the event. He was very conscious of the web being cast by the new German secret state police, the Gestapo, and he sensed they would be watching how he responded. The letter was of no importance, but would the Gestapo realise that? Would the family now be under suspicion for having links with Britain? Kieks' reaction to the letter was to think back to the happier times before the war and the relaxed atmosphere which seemed so far away. The letter had a deeper impact on Willem and seemed to galvanise him. He told the family he was not prepared to sit back and do nothing, and he started analysing the shape of the house to see if there were any corners that might provide a good hiding space in the future. There was a roof space above their apartment, but it would be the first place anyone would look in a search. However, there seemed to be a mismatch between the inside and the outside construct of the building, which he tried to resolve. He studied the house from every angle, and even climbed out onto the roof to get a different perspective. As he climbed through the skylight window, Kieks teased him, asking if she now had a squirrel for a brother. However, as he clambered over the roof, Willem became increasingly excited. The roof ran to a large chimney stack, which incorporated the chimneys of their own house, before continuing to the neighbour's stairwell. When he looked closely, he became convinced that the structure was an architectural decoration, designed to cover the join between the two buildings, and was largely ornamental, probably containing a void. It adjoined their top floor, so if he could go through the wall of the box room, he would be able to get directly into that space. Willem finally decided to put his hunch to the test. Grasping a hammer and chisel, he started knocking through the wall in the box room. With clouds of dust and debris billowing in all directions, he was soon able to make a small hole in the wall. Peeking through with a torch, he discovered a chamber some 21 feet long by about 4 feet wide, 6.5 metres by 1.1 metres. The roof was only about 4 feet, 1.2 metres, above floor level, and would be too low for someone to stand upright under it, but there was plenty of space to store things. Excited about his discovery, Willem decided to convert it into a usable storage chamber. Kieks was amused at his animated reaction, but she was not convinced that the storage space was needed. However, she could tell that Willem was unsettled and had an urge to do something, and she felt that this was perhaps something harmless that would take his mind off the war and the oppressive atmosphere around them. Before he could set about converting the secret chamber, he felt he had to speak with his neighbour in the adjoining apartment, since the man was technically the owner of the void. The owner was Toyn Fundeen, a policeman whom they had occasionally spoken to in the months since moving to The Hague. Since returning from the front, Willem had already become intensely secretive, and although he sensed Toyn shared their antipathy towards the Nazis, he avoided going into detail. There was a vague discussion where nothing specific was said or described, but by the end of it, Willem was convinced that he was free to modify the space into a storeroom. Later, Toyn was to become a close friend and confidant of the family. Willem worked on his pet project all summer. The chamber was small, but that made it inconspicuous, and there were no windows, no plaster on the inner walls, nor even floorboards or lights. The height of the structure was also an advantage. From the outside, it was an insignificant part of the original building, and looked like an oversized chimney stack. There were no real shortages of building materials in the first year of the war, and Willem was relatively unhindered as he went about refurbishing it. Kieks was happy to help, and keen to make sure that he did not make too much of a mess in the adjoining room, which was to be her seamstress's workroom. She was soon moving buckets of rubble out to the back of the house and helping to dispose of it discreetly. Willem fitted floorboards and other primitive furnishings, including long, deep storage shelves across part of the void. He finished the entrance from the box room, leaving an opening only about 2 feet by 2 feet wide, with its bottom edge some 3 feet above floor level. Impractical for a room, but fine for a secret storage area. Willem fitted a modest mirror over the hole to provide a concealed entrance into the hidden chamber. The mirror was intended to look like a dressing mirror, so it was the same width as the opening, but taller, extending above the opening, and again of a modest size to make it inconspicuous. He mounted the mirror on concealed hinges with an ingenious catch so that the mirror door could be opened from either side. As he inspected it, he tapped it. When it was tapped at the bottom, it perhaps sounded hollow, but when it was tapped near the top, it sounded quite solid. It would have to do. Finally, he completely redecorated the box room to hide all traces of the work. If anyone searched the house and asked what the room was and why there was a mirror, this was where Kieks worked and fitted clothes to her customer's satisfaction. Downstairs, he modified the bedroom windows and fitted two small mirrors. These he set so that it was possible to stand out of sight from the street and look up and down the full length of the road. Now, finished with her schooling, Kieks wanted to find a job. But with the war in progress, there were few opportunities around. She reasoned that if she didn't have a job of sort, she would end up doing more and more of the housework, so she was excited at the chance to start up a small business taking in sewing work. She was soon able to get some jobs adjusting and repairing people's clothes, which also helped give her a sense of being an adult and contributing to the family household. She was aware that as the youngest, and clearly her mother's pet, the rest of the family did not take her completely seriously. This gave her some privileges, but also reduced the attention she was able to command in family discussions. During 1940, the first year of the war, the German forces in Holland were preoccupied with establishing their presence. Before the war, each local administration had created a Bevolkingsregister, a register of every citizen, and now the occupying authorities issued an order that required every citizen to fill in a form that determined if they were Jewish, according to certain criteria. The form was filled in by most Dutch citizens, including the Jews, and it became a crucial appendix to the Bevolkingsregister, which now added religion to the record of each individual's personal details. With these details added to the register, the Jews were officially identified, and the persecution of the Jews would begin within months. By November that year, Jewish civil servants were being dismissed from their posts, and by the end of the year, all Jews had to be registered with the authorities. Once they had registered, their fate was sealed. Now identified as Jews, they would experience harassment and progressively be forced to live ever more apart from the rest of the population. Many Dutch folk were unhappy about the treatment being meted out, as the Jews had always been accepted as part of Dutch society. However, the Dutch way of life at the time was for each group and social class to live their own lives in relatively separate communities. The persecution bemused Kieks, who didn't yet fully see the significance of what was happening.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.